Good afternoon all. Fresh beginnings always exist. We only have to welcome them. On this wonderful day, it gives me immense pleasure to welcome you all for this innovative and informative session organized by IAC and Anavali Arts and Science College. I heartily welcome the chief guest, principal, staff, students to this session. Now I request Mrs. Keetana, Assistant Professor, Department of English, Anavali Arts and Science College, to introduce the resource person.
A very good afternoon to all. I take immense pleasure in welcoming and introducing the speaker of session 2 of this program to the virtual gathering. Mr. B.S. Lokesh is graduated in chemical engineering from Bangalore University in 1983. He has also done PGD-FDM from Institute of Management, Calcutta. He has been a trainer at various programs. He has trained 200 odd educational consultants and has been a freelance trainer for financial advisors in life insurance. His training expertise includes communication, leadership, organizational development, interpersonal skills, sales and marketing, entrepreneur development, and many such areas. He possesses 10 years of experience in training soft skills, sales and marketing, and entrepreneurial development programs, and 20 years of experience in the field of marketing and manufacturing of basic chemicals. We're highly happy in having you amongst us today, sir. Looking forward for a wonderful session. Thank you for the opportunity given.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, madam. Sir, it's up to you for the session.
Yes. Thank you so much. Can you hear me loud?
Yes.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Am I visible?
Yeah, sir. You're visible and audible too.
Another confirmation. I hope I'm audible.
Yes, sir. You're audible.
Okay, fine. Great. Good afternoon to all of you. It gives me an immense pleasure to be a part of this wonderful learning session from your great esteemed institution. Today, I have been assigned to talk on the different, levels, different ways of fostering entrepreneurship and innovation among students. I will just check my, screen. I'll start sharing, just tell me. Is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, okay. Yeah, I take this opportunity. I want to thank the whole management, the faculty, and the members of IAC and the other invitees, guests, and in the last, but not the least, my good dear students. Before I really, dive into my presentation, I just want to take you through a very small history of global economy, because we have witnessed different terrains of economy over a period of 100 years, and we have been seeing changes happening every day because of the invasion and advent of technology. Things are going at a very high speed. Whatever you are inventing today, it's obsolete by tomorrow. That's what. If we happen to combat this situation, if we happen to fight it, and if we happen to survive, what is that we should learn? Before that, I will take you through a very small journey of the changes that have happened over a period of time. Because it started, revolutions, a few revolutions took place. The first one was steam engine revolution or locomotive engines. That was the first beginning of industrialization of the globe. And next started the manufacturing activities. There was a whole lot of revolution in European countries, and especially in the field of automobile and engineering. Later came 80s, the invasion of information technology, which has completely changed, complete the domain, the terrain of the world economy. There was a complete paradigm shift in terms of learning, in terms of, you know, like economic changes that are going to take place. We are entirely in a different level of level playing stage today. That's what. So at that point of time, when technology and information technology started invading, there was a, you know, boom of dot-coms. Dot-coms are nothing but your, you know, what, e-commerce platforms. So these e-commerce platforms, what they did, they completely sublimed, they completely slaughtered the conventional way of doing business. Sitting at home, you can buy anything. Within minutes, within, you know, like hours, you can get the product, whatever you want. So this change, almost in the last 20, 30 years, we have been witnessing this change of e-commerce. There are plenty of, like, you know, like e-commerce platforms that every day, you know, like coming up with different products, different services, serving the customer base. But today, maybe in the last 5-6 years, we are hearing something called artificial intelligence. This is the latest technological, you know, bubblings that's happening in order to take mankind to a different level. What is this artificial intelligence? What's it going to do? Artificial intelligence is a field of technology, information technology, that's going to control the human brain. You will be controlled. You will be, you know, like guided to do the things what the machine wants. In a situation like this, there is a, you know, like a threat. There is a thing where we are going to lose our jobs. It's a deep threat for economy. It's a deep threat for human beings. All our jobs are going to be taken over by the machines. In a situation like this, what should we do? Yes, we should work at, you know, like creating jobs. Creating jobs is nothing but entrepreneurship. So all of us, we have to develop an attitude called an entrepreneur attitude so that we can do something, start something. Not only we can survive, you can provide jobs to other people. This is the whole situation that we are around now. Okay. In order to do this, let's learn something about entrepreneurship and the, you know, like how to improve the qualities, how to improve, you know, how to build in the entrepreneurship qualities in, you know, like, especially today, I am talking about students. Are you with me so far? Are you with me, my friends? Can you hear me? I'm not getting any answer. Hello? 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 Hello?
Sir, it is audible. Hello? Sir.
I'm audible. Please answer me, because I don't want any...
It is audible, sir.
Please, ma'am. I want somebody to say yes when I say something.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
Or if it doesn't work, please tell me. Okay. Thank you so much. Okay. So let's start today's session by trying to understand the basics of entrepreneurship and the ways we can foster some of these qualities. Okay. Yeah. How do you define an entrepreneur? That's very important. Before we really go into fostering the qualities of an entrepreneur, or, you know, like building the qualities for an entrepreneur, let's understand what's an entrepreneur. An entrepreneur is an individual who creates new business, bearing most of the risks and enjoying most of the profits too. The process of setting up a business is called entrepreneurship. The entrepreneur is commonly seen as an innovator, a source of new ideas, products, services, and business and procedures. See, these are some of the basic things. See, everybody cannot become an entrepreneur. You need to have certain qualities. Certain qualities, like you have to, an entrepreneur is the one who starts from scratch. The whole business enterprise, he will start from the beginning. In order to start from the beginning, he should be an innovator. He should have that mind of innovation. He has to be innovative. He has to come up with a product or service, looking at the customer base, looking at the customer needs and wants. And running a business is not just a simple thing. It's not like 9-to-5 job. Lot of risk is involved. So one has to be ready to take that risk. We call it as calculated risk in business. So an entrepreneur is the one who starts from zero, who starts from the scratch, and he builds an enterprise, runs an enterprise, and tries to get profit out of it, and in turn provide jobs to many people. This is what the basic gist, the theme of an entrepreneur. So he will have not only have the ideas regarding the products, he should also know how to run the business. But there are two things when you are working an enterprise, when you are in a journey of a startup, there are two things which are very, very important, my dear friends. One is product development, business development. Both the things have to go in hand in order to have a desired results. In order to be successful, you need to know about the product. Product development is nothing but the technological aspect of it and the business model. The business model involves your marketing, your sales, branding, and funding. These are all the things which are embedded in business model. So an entrepreneur need to have a vast things, many a characters he has to learn in order to be successful. So why I'm trying to tell you is, before we go and find out the different ways to foster entrepreneurship, let's know what are the basic qualities that are required by an entrepreneur to run an enterprise, to run a startup, to start a startup. Is that clear? Hope you're with me, my friends. Just an S from an audio S.
Yes, okay? Sir.
Okay, fine. Thank you so much. Okay. Shia, what is the importance of an entrepreneur? What he's going to do? What are the benefits of running an enterprise? Entrepreneurs provide jobs. That's what I was talking about. When we are at a stage where we are going to be knocked down by machines for a period of time, we need to create jobs. It's the duty of an entrepreneur. He's going to create jobs for the people. And when you are an entrepreneur, he's going to increase competition, healthy competition, and boost productivity. Because any nation's economy has to be built on two characters. One is agriculture and the next one is production. These are the two strong pillars of any nation's economy. But unfortunately, today our economy is completely based on service segment. To be very honest, service segment, service industry should complement these two, the production and the agriculture. The production is nothing but, manufacturing. So in order to boost an entrepreneur, when he takes up a product, he will be creating a healthy competition as well as he will boost the productivity. Entrepreneur create businesses and new markets. He is going to explore the market. How? He has created a product which will suffice, which will serve the new need of the client. So he is creating a new market. In addition to this, he is building, he is promoting, he is contributing to the economy of the nation in terms of jobs, in terms of tax, in terms of revenues. He is going to help the nation and he is going to help the nation and, contribute to the GDP of the nation. So not only that, we have seen over a period of time, you're all from education institutions. I know a lot of research, usually that too takes place in all institutions. It's not only technical, And you have a lot of, PhDs are there. You have worked on so many issues. You have really, worked hard in order to achieve that. No doubt you have got a PhD degree for that. But end of the day, unless your degree, unless the research you have carried on, if it doesn't, it's not applied practically, if it's not brought into practice, the purpose is not served. The whole essence of creativity is lost. So an entrepreneur can do that. You as research people, you have developed something. You have developed some technology and innovation. But an entrepreneur is the one who takes it up and makes it practical, convert into a product or a service and help people. So these are the advantages. These are the benefits of being an entrepreneur. Okay. Because I need to understand this. Because simply, I'll start something. No, it doesn't work that way. There are some core issues. there are core requirements of an entrepreneur. So these are the etiquette, ethics of an entrepreneur. This is how the whole entrepreneur, the startup journey should start. You should have all these things in your mind. Yes, I have to provide a job. I have to promote. I have to help the nation by, you know, giving some contribution to the GDP. That is the notion with which you should start an enterprise, my dear friends. Are you with me? Okay. Hope I'm audible.
Sir, it is audible. Actually, yes, it is YouTube live, sir.
What's the problem, ma'am?
It is YouTube live.
Oh, YouTube, is it? Fine. Okay, not an issue.
Okay.
Absolutely fine. I understand. Not an issue. Okay. So now coming to the types of entrepreneurs, we can just classify. Of course, you can classify in so many issues, but in general classifications, we can classify it into four categories. One is a small business entrepreneurs who run, these people, we call it as bootstrapped entrepreneurs. They run very small businesses out of their own funds and they don't go into any financial assistance from any bank or, you know, like whatever venture capitalists or VC or angel investors. They don't do that. They start business on their own with the limited capital what they have. And they start recycling in the sense that whatever the profits they get in, they plow in again, they put it and they take advances from customers. So that's one basic thing. So all small business enterprises are bootstrapped in India. The next one is people like you, entrepreneurs, should think scalable startup and entrepreneur. This is where the whole diversification takes place. The startup entrepreneur starts a business knowing that their vision can change the world. You have a vision. You want to earn and you will come up with a mission statement. You have some targets to be met. You attract investors. You want people to fund your organization, fund your startup. And you are the one who will think out of the box. That's very, very important because business is not just normal thinking. You have to think out of the box of many things like critical thinking comes, design thinking comes in, paradoxical thinking, and so many such thinkings make a very right entrepreneur. Unless you work on it, you cannot face the competition. You cannot challenge. So this kind of, you know, like mindset is very important. This is what we are banking upon. Scalable startup entrepreneurs and students can work on this area. This is the segment. This is the area where people you fall. Okay. The next is large company, like, you know, like corporates and all. They already established ones. They go, they diversify, they do all those things. It's fair enough. Let's not worry too much about that. Social entrepreneur, these are the people, these people do not work for any profit. They work for the betterment of the communities. They may work in rural areas, they may work in tribal areas, and some areas which are totally ignored. In order to, you know, strike a socio-economic balance, these entrepreneurs work on non-profit basis. So these are the different four types of entrepreneurs that usually we can classify. It's just for your knowledge, my dear friends. Yes. Now, what are the skills that are required for an entrepreneur? This is very important. Unless you have the skills, you cannot run the business. I told you, knowledge alone will not suffice for you to be successful. You cannot have a startup. You cannot have a successful startup journey unless you have skills, the basic skills. What are these basic skills? Business management skills, teamwork and leadership skills, communication and listening, financial skills, critical thinking skills. I was talking about that. Thinking is very, very important. Business management. What are the things you'll have to manage in business? It's not your technology alone. You have to manage, the marketing, you have to manage the, you know, like the finance part of it and the HR. Suppose if you're running an organization where about 20, 30 people are working with you, how do you manage? How do you take along with him? You have to possess wonderful leadership qualities. A leader should lead from the front. Unless you lead, you have to take people along with you. That's the time when you can get good results and you have to possess the skills. You should have that, you know, like you should have that foresight. What's going to happen in the next 2 or 3 years? You have to have that vision. of the business? Where do you stand in the next 5 years competition? What do you want to do if there are many players are coming in the market? All these plans, that is, we call it a situational awareness. You have to be aware of the situation. You should be constantly watching both the market and the customer. And communication and listening is very, very vital, my friends. Because most of the time, we feel, of course, there are two things. One is speaking and the other one is listening. Both are equally important. You have to be a good communicator. You have to be a good speaker. The way in which you speak is very vital as a leader, as a businessman. And listening skills. You have to listen to your team. You have to listen to your customers. You have to listen to your, like people who are associated with you, with whom you are affiliated. Maybe the bankers, maybe the market people, maybe your legal entities. You have to listen to them. You should have that patience of listening. Most of the time, what we do is we fail to listen to people. People want to be heard. People want to address their grievances. That's an area where you need to empathize so that you will understand the problems. In order to understand the problems, unless you understand the problems of a customer, how can you develop a product? In order to understand the problem, you need to be a very good listener. At this point in time, I want to tell you a very small story which is so impactful, which shows the importance of listening. Okay. This is again of a salesperson. There was a salesperson. He was a sales executive working in a company. He was supposed to sell television sets to people. Salespeople are always target oriented. I have to sell this much of units in this quarter and this much of units in this quarter. This is normally, we are target oriented business. That's what sales is all about. You will be fixed a target. So you have to achieve this. So this man was selling the televisions to all the people. And end of that quarter, he was running shortage of freezer, limit. He had to sell another 30, 40 units so that he would meet his target. He was panicked. He was pensive. He was pausing by the way. He got down from a bus. And suddenly he came across a village. It was a very small tribal village. He just wanted to, since he was very, upset, he just wanted to go through and find out what's happening over there. He just walked in. To his surprise, he saw those complete tribal community sitting around a bonfire. It was late in the evening, maybe around 6:30, 7 or 8 o'clock in the evening. There was a fire lit and they were sitting around, they were circled and they were talking to each other. They were narrating their stories. They were enjoying. It was a time for them to relax. They would listen to each other carefully. One man would narrate one of his story. The other people would, listen to it, laugh it. They were enjoying totally. And they were telling stories. This man felt, yes, this is the right place for me to do some business. What he did, he asked him, "What are you doing here?" He said, "We are telling stories and we are listening to stories." "Oh, is it? Are your stories so wonderful?" They said, "Yes, absolutely. We have stories from mythology. We have stories from history and wonderful stories." He said, "Suppose if I give you something which can tell better stories in a better manner, the pictorial one, a graphical one, a live one." They were astonished. "What is it? What is it you are going to give us?" He said, "I will give you something called television sets. It will give you serials. It will give you everything about sports. You can see stories about sports, about the Ramayana, Mahabharata. What you name the thing, there is a story for you." And they said, "Fine, wonderful. We'll buy." So each of them booked one television, almost 30, 40 televisions he could sell. He was very happy. He was excited and he met his target. It was a wonderful day for him. So over a period of time, maybe after 5-6 months, he just wanted to come and see what these people are doing with the televisions. He came back. To his greatest surprise, all these television sets were stacked in some corner. And he was astonished. He was confused a bit. "What's this? I gave them such wonderful television sets. They are not using. What has happened to them? He called that Mukhiyar somebody, the important person, asked him, why gentlemen, what happened to you people? Why are you not, you know, using my television sets? They are so wonderful. He said, your televisions tell us the stories, but they don't listen to us. So people want to be heard. A leader should have that quality to listen to people carefully, that to an attentive listener, active listener. You cannot be a passive listener. So listening is so important, my dear friends. So the story is just to manifest the importance of listening. So as a leader, as a businessman, have that patience to listen to your grievances of a customer. That's where the whole analogy works. That's where you start developing a product. It's only when you listen, you will understand their needs. It's only when they complain about your product, there's a way for you to improve it. The flaws have to be rectified. The shortfalls can be mended. Pitfalls can be corrected. Any pain points can be addressed beautifully when you listen to people. Please, as an entrepreneur, develop those habits of listening habits. Okay. Because I'm stressing on these points. You must be wondering, my topic is to, you know, like show how to improve. Not an issue. Basically, please try to understand the basics of businessmen, business enterprises, the basic qualities that are required for you to be successful. Fine. Is that right? You can just tell me if I'm not able. That's all. Okay. Fine. Fair enough. Yeah. This is a simple flow chart of a journey of an enterprise. The journey starts like this. You have an idea. Okay. You have developed some idea. Some idea struck your mind. Okay. Yes, I have to start something with this. Maybe some of you, most of the present buzzy, what's going on around is that mobile apps. Many of the students have, because whenever I come in contact with students, they all say, we want to develop some app. I have already developed some app, no doubt. But developing an app doesn't completely take you to the right position in business. No. There's a lot of things. Once you have an idea, in order to bring that idea into a product or a service, you have to collaborate. Collaboration with so many, you know, like you need to affiliate. You need to collaborate with people around. Collaborate with financial institutions, in the market segment, and the legal entities. So you have to rope up all these people in order to take your startup journey in a good way, in a right way. Then you start developing a product. Then financing comes. You have to look at the finance part. That's very, very important. You have an idea. You have affiliated. You have registered. You have developed a product. But without finance, what's that you're going to do? You need to work on funding. That's absolutely the lifeline of a business enterprises. Without money, nothing works. You need to contact. In order to get that, you should be well prepared. You should be in a position to convince that your idea works. How does the idea works? There are two things, my dear friends. If you want to be a successful entrepreneur, you have to work on two theories. One is, how do you reduce the cost of production? Over a period of time, you just watch these electronic gadgets. A mobile phone, which was almost like a machine of almost 500 grams, 1 kilo, it would cost around 40,000-50,000 when it came into the market. Of course, there are wonderful, high-tech mobiles, which may cost more than lakh. I'm not talking about that. I am talking about the basic version. Over a period of time, every day you are witnessing competition. What is that competition? Today you have a set, you have a mobile set. It has got certain features. Tomorrow another one will come. He is telling, see, I have a better battery backup. My battery is around 6000 mAh, whatever that you say. And better storage capacity and a higher, with a processor of high speed. So what's happening is here, every day in this mobile technology, value addition is taking place. Got my point? So if you are working on something, think of value adding to the product. That's very, very important. The same mobile which you bought it for around 20,000-25,000, maybe the next 15-20 days, another person comes to the market. Yes, with the same set of features, with a better look, with a better aesthetics, I can give you the mobile for 23,000. What's happening here? Cost reduction. The reduction factor is taking place in manufacturing. Conversely, the quality, the service, the features of the product are in upward movement. So these two factors are inversely proportional. If you are improving the quality, you cannot just, you know, say I'm doing good thing. No, you have to work on reducing the cost of manufacturing. Today we are in buyer's market. The buyer is dictating. You have to step into the shoes of a customer and find out what does he wants. There are two parameters which normally work. One is user-centric and human-centric. These user-centric principles are the desires and wants of a customer. Customer wants something. He wants some fancy things. And why does he want? When it comes to the question of human-centric, his emotions play a vital role. Emotions are attached to every product what human beings use. So better you start learning these two, you know, like things to understand the desires and want of a customer as well as the emotions. So constantly you should be reading a customer. Constantly you should be studying the market. Constantly you should be watching the market in order to be successful. Hope these things are clear, my friends. Yeah, now let's come to the thing what we are supposed to look in for today. Yeah, this is about how to develop entrepreneurial skills. So this is very important. I told you I was talking the different, you know, areas in which an entrepreneur should learn things, should practice so many skills. That's what. See, there was a time when a knowledge was just sufficient. Suppose if you awarded a good degree, suppose if you have got some wonderful knowledge to share, if you feel that you are a well-read person, that would suffice for survival. But today, knowledge is just a part of survival. Knowledge has to be complemented with something called skills. We are in a skill arena. Every enterprise, every domain of profession, every profession wants you to have the right skills for that particular discipline. What is skill? Skill is to utilize your knowledge effectively and efficiently. That's very important. Knowledge can only be brought into practical knowledge, can be converted into a product or service with skills. The whole journey from knowledge to product, the whole thing involves the complete happening of, you know, complete arrangement of complete existence of skills. So you need to inculcate these skills. We have to dig in. We have to start introspecting. What are the different areas I am lacking in? What is that I don't possess of all the characters we discussed so far? How can I really improve those things? This is how you need to improve your skills. Start refining your ideas. Start refining your, you know, whatever the talents you have in a skill pattern. So, not only skilling, you need to reskill, upskill. If you already have some skills, you should start refining them over a period of time. There'll be change, everyday change happening. Unless you refine, unless you upskill, you will not be able to thrive in the market. So interpersonal skills. The interpersonal skill means this one of the skill that's very vital. How do you interact with the people? How do you greet the people? Greet a person with a smile. Do you know? Smile is the shortest curve. That is the shortest curve which sets everything straight. Smile is the shortest distance between two people. So keep smiling. I don't mean it's artificial. You need to inculcate. You should be a cheerful person. That's because I'm trying to, you know, like dig into the basics. Since you are students, I don't want to take you to the different terrain with complex ideas. No. These are basic skills which can do wonders. Refine your interpersonal skills. Start talking to people. Be empathetic. Try to understand one's need. Try to find out what is the problem. You will have to always address the problem first. Before you want to sell anything, before you want to develop anything, address the problems. Identify the problems. Then only you can think of a solution. And you should be approachable. Don't develop any attitude that you are an entrepreneur. Yes, I am doing this, nothing. No, you should be as simple as possible. You should reciprocate positively. Reciprocation is very vital in business, my dear friends. Unless you reciprocate, whether it's happening or not, maybe every act of business may not bring you the profit. But there are some etiquettes. There are principles in business. You need to talk to your customers, whether it's financial institution, whether it's a customer base, whether it's your vendor, whoever it is. Communication is very important. You have to talk to them whenever they want to talk to you, whenever they want something. Whether you can do that at the particular point of time, that's a different issue. Talk to them. If you can't serve them at that point, borrow some time. Tell, okay, I'm tied up with something I'll not be able to do. Please, I beg to borrow a bit of time so that I can serve you better. That's all. And if you have done mistakes, please accept. Unless you accept, there is no room for modification. You have to understand, we are all human beings. We are bound to mistakes. And, you know, you have to learn from mistakes. There are lots of lessons to be learned from a loser than a winner. There's not much of a difference between loser and a winner. You know, in Olympic race, 100 meters running, you can take, it's a sprint that's being called the, you know, fastest running activity. The person who wins that is called, he's destined to be called as the fastest man on the universe. The man who has won the race and the second one, the runner, you know the difference? 0.001 second or 0.001. 1/100th of a second or 1/10th of a second can differentiate between winner and loser. The same amount of efforts. He is winner, he is loser. So even a loser will have definitely put that kind of efforts. End of the day, we have to say he is winner, he is loser. Nevertheless, don't worry too much. Don't dig too much. Try to travel in that particular path. Take that wonderful journey. That's very, very important. Be confident. You have to be confident. You have a lot of confidence. It's very important because you will be encountering different situations. Lot of, you know, like, contingencies, they are going to take place in business. Unforeseen circumstances will arise. You have to be prepared enough to face such situations. In order to face that kind of a situations, you need to be confident in life, my dear friends. Connect with entrepreneurs. Networking is very, very vital. You have to talk to people. You have to find out who are all the people, who are the players. They are in your area, in your domain, in your business enterprise. Talk to them. Healthy competition. Find out what they are doing, how they are doing. Connect to the See, develop a healthy, you know, atmosphere. You have to respect your, you know, competitors. You have to admire them for the work they are doing. You can't develop hatred and run a business. No, it doesn't work that way. So there'll be a lot of community programs. There'll be a lot of associations. There are a lot of, you know, things people associate themselves. So maybe manufacturing of some particular item, maybe service in, you know, maybe any different services. They'll be having associations. Today, you know, lots of groups, because digital marketing has become so vast. It has occupied every domain of business. Try to get affiliated with such people. Try to find out their experiences. Share the knowledge, what you have. And also learn from people. Resilience, it's very, very important. See, normally the human tendency is whenever we face problems, we will run away. That's very, very, very wrong notion, my dear friends. Suppose if you don't have a solution for the problem, be resilient. Hang on for some time. At some point of time, a solution definitely evolves. But we fail to do that. What we do is, the moment we face a problem, we lose all the confidence and we feel, yes, let me wind off this show. No, you should never do that. In order to have that sustainability, be resilient enough to face the situations. No matter you have the solution or not, hang on there. Hang on for some time. And you have to de-stress yourself. You cannot do business having a whole lot of stress in your mind. Forget, the moment you are back home, business is different. Your personal and family life is different. Let your business side stress be limited to your business area only, the place where you do the business. Come and relax. You will start with a wonderful morning, a day with new ideas. Don't carry on the stress. Just, you know, like unfold the stress in that business area only. And the most important thing is, you should be a learner all the time. We are all students. Absolutely, learning is a thing which has no end. Every moment, every minute you come across, you can learn things, my dear friends. So be a learner always. So learning is very vital in business. At any point of time, don't say, yes, I know everything, I have done everything. No, nothing like that. There is always a room to learn things. We are all learners. Till the end of the life, you can learn, I'll tell you. So be a learner all the time. Be a good learner. Learn with a lot of interest and curiosity. Because unless you learn, you cannot, you know, bring anything into practice. So you be a good learner. So learning is very, very important in business. Hope these points are clear for you. Yeah. Fostering leadership. Leadership is the quality that is required for an entrepreneur. And because as a businessman, you will have to lead from the front. You will have to take your team along with you. Because people want to be guided by you, motivated by you. You need to participate. You need to take people along with you. You will have to lead from the front. Any risk, you should be the one to shoulder. Suppose if a customer has some problem, some critical problem, some of your person, maybe salesperson or a service person, may not be able to handle it. At that point in time, don't escape. You go personally, address the issue to the best of your capacity. If not, as I told you, borrow some time. Try to fix it with some people, some professional. So don't run away. Be a leader. A leader will always be the first one to address the problem. He will start leading from the front to address any problem in business. So when it comes to the question of leadership, we have different styles of leadership. So many leaderships. One is autocratic, is an authority. Always he says, yes, I'm the boss. I know all the thing. I'm going to rule. This is called autocratic or authoritarian leadership in business. And the next one is democratic, not participative. This is the thing where leaders participate in every activity. A businessman participates in every activity. He doesn't just sit at the top and he doesn't order for people to do that. He will involve himself in every activity of the business right from bottoms up. He will go to the lowest level to address the issues. One is free rein. This is, you know, like a liberal one. A liberal leader. He's almost, he doesn't command anybody. He will only guide them. He will give some instructions. And the other one is paternalistic or fatherly. He is like head of the family. He shows a lot of affection. He shows a lot of concern for his team, for his people who are working with him. So this is. But what I'm trying to tell you is, you should be an amalgamation of all these qualities. You can't just dictate and get the things done. You can't freely, democratically, okay, friend, no, you cannot do that. you have to act as per the situation. Maybe at some point of time in business, you will have to be cutthroat. It may not be a right word, but still, you need to be an authority. You need to be authority, and means you should have that knowledge and capacity. This kind of, you know, governance is done in armed forces, military. So there, this authoritarian leadership works. So you have to cultivate and make an amalgamation of all these leadership qualities. Because leadership is very, very important, my dear friends. Unless you're a leader, unless you lead from the front, unless you understand the problems as a leader, you will not be able to solve the issues. You cannot have a good startup journey. So start inculcating these leadership qualities. See, it's not any rocket science. It's just a simple thought process. Start introspecting. What are your, you know, pitfalls? What do you lack to be a leader? What are the different areas you have to mend? So work on those and start becoming a good leader. Listen to some motivational stories of great leaders. People who have done wonders, who have achieved many, many things in life. Listen to their stories. Listen to some motivational, you know, like speakers. There are a lot of people who motivate you. They will tell you, they will give you the basics of leadership. In order to do all these things, a leader will be first, he will be disciplined. Very, very important. You cannot be shabby if you are not disciplined. The whole organization will not be disciplined. We have to show, yes, discipline is a very vital and the most needed aspect of any business enterprises. So a good leader will always be disciplined. So start working more in order to cultivate, inculcate more of leadership qualities. Start working more, get into more areas. Try to, you know, like gain more knowledge. So an involvement is very important. A great way to develop your leadership skills is to take on more responsibility. This is what the leadership means. You have to be responsible for everything. Start shouldering the responsibility. Don't run away. This comes by practice. Get into certain issues. Get into certain areas where you can handle responsibilities. That may be very simple one. Doesn't matter. Take some responsibility. Suppose you have a peer group. You have to address some problem of some of your friend. You start leading. Guide them. Take the responsibility. Discuss with the people. Share their ideas. You can find a solution. That's how you can, you know, like season and develop your leadership qualities. Learn to follow. If you want to be a good leader, be a follower. Unless you follow, you can't lead. So following is the most important quality of a good leader. And I was talking about situational awareness. You have to understand the situation. You may come across different situations, and especially in business. Because we are living in a world called VUCA world. The business, whole business atmosphere, business terrain is in VUCA world. What is VUCA world? Vulnerable, uncertain. We never know what's going to happen tomorrow. The whole thing is so uncertain and complex. Complex because so many players in the market. Plenty of players. Every minute people are coming. And especially since the whole world is exposed to digital marketing, you must be watching. You must be watching wherever you go. That business, you know, enterprises, they come and advertise in all the medias, whether it's Facebook, Twitter, WhatsApp, whatever it is. So lots and lots of people are coming to this business arena. So it's very important to know what's happening over. How many players are coming in the market? What is that they're coming with? What is their product? In what way they're better than mine? So you need to be very watchful to understand the market and the customer and start inspiring others. A leader has to inspire. If your people have to work, You have to inspire. That's what I have come here to do. I want to inspire you people to take up this journey, to develop these, you know, like skills of an entrepreneur. So be always motivative. Start motivating people. Inspire people. Tell them good stories of inspiration. Keep learning. Learning has no ending at all. It has no end. You have to keep on learning. Learn with interest. Learn with interest. And resolution of conflicts is very, very important. What happens? Suppose if you allow it to grow, you will reach a stage, there won't be any solution. Then and there, when some conflict arises, try to solve it. Find out some solution. Always try, don't go for an interim solution. Think of creating a permanent solution. Because at some point of time, it may again pop up and lead to more complex situation. So, the other one, be a discerning listener. I told you about the importance of listening. I think you understood that story. So, listen to people. So, these are all the things which you can practice on your own. And first of all, you should understand the needs. Yes, these are all the things which I need to learn, I need to inculcate, I need to practice. Have that, you know, learning attitude. Definitely over a period of time, there will be paradigm shift in terms of your thinking. When you really, you know, some people will definitely notice and tell you, hey, such kind of a change, I'm, you know, like finding in you. That will be the reaction of the people. So it's just a practice. It's, I told you, it's not a rocket science. Nobody is born with all the talent. No, nothing like that. You can learn. That's very important. It's just practice. It's just a practice and the interest. You need to be passionate about your work. That's very important, my dear friends. Love the work, what you do. Then you will not find it difficult. You will find it easier. You will have a thrill. You will encounter a lot of thrill in that. So these are all the things which you need to, and especially these all come under leadership. So first, be a good leader. Yeah, this is how one, you know, great writer, that's how he defines a leader. Excuse me. Yeah, a leader must be tough enough to fight. Yes, you need to be a very tough man to fight. Tender enough to cry. You are a human. You have emotions. Express it. Be tender. Be soft. You are human enough to make mistakes. Nevertheless, whatever it is, you see, when situation comes which is out of your control, you are bound to make mistakes, but not knowingly, unknowingly, without the situation being in your control. Mistakes do happen, but try to learn from them and be humble. Be honest enough to admit your mistakes. Strong enough to absorb the pain. You should be in a position to take that pain in you. And resilient enough to bounce back. At some point of time, when things may look very docile, I think you may be, people may be talking, you have been knocked out. He is no more in the race. No. Be silent at that point in time. And there is always a time when you can bounce back and keep on moving. So this is a wonderful definition of a good leader, a business leader. You know, this was quoted by Jesse Jackson. Yeah, now coming, this is the most important thing where you can cultivate. This is one of the, because I told I will be addressing these issues under four subheadings. One is leadership. I have talked about leadership now, and design thinking. And I have another two things which we'll see later. Okay, what is design thinking? You must be wondering, what is this design thinking is all about? It's a linear, non-linear iterative process, human-centric, in order to solve, I will explain you, don't worry. In order to solve complex problems and unknown problems. So there are different stages in this design thinking. One is empathize. This is the first thing. Empathize means you have to get into a customer's shoe. You have to get into a user's shoe. You have to become user yourselves. normally what do when there is somebody suffering from problems, we just sympathize. Oh, I'm so sorry it happened to you. No, not that. You should go to the next level to be empathetic enough to understand that pain, understand the need, understand what's the situation he's undergoing. So you can only understand the situation, you'll be able to understand the situation rather, when you empathize. You need to empathize always. That's how. That's an area where you will get the complete picture of the problem. Why? What's that he needs? What's his, you know, pain point? What is that he lacks? What is that he wants in that? Which is the area these products are failing to serve him? So you will be studying in detail, in person, the needs of the customer as if you're experiencing one. So that is what the stage called empathetic empathize. Empathize means feeling the problem, experiencing the problem as if it's yours. Again, the next stage is, yes, you have completely, you know, got into the shoes of your customer. Now you have understood. Now you are making a mission statement. That is, you are defining the problem. You are defining what exactly he needs, the particular area which has to be addressed so that my product or service can be implemented. So you are understanding the problems. You are understanding that particular point of problem and which you are defining. That's very important, my dear friends. See, when you are trying to develop something, unless you know the root cause of the development. See, any invention, necessity is the mother of invention, as you all know. Any invention is always based on some need. So when you are thinking, you should know what is that particular, you should know in clear, you should have a complete clarity about the problems that your user is undergoing. So this comes under an important quality of a business entrepreneur. It's very important. You need to know the problem. You need to understand. You need to define it. Yes, it's a clear-cut issue now. I've identified. Things are fine now. Yes, this is the particular problem I'm going to address. Okay. You have got into the customers. You have felt his problem. You have, with an analogical mind, you have noticed, you have, you know, analyzed everything and completely got to the heart of the problem. You have understood what's the problem is all about. Next you ideate. So you will start developing ideas to solve the issue, to develop a product, to develop a service what this customer needs. Ideation, this is the most important thing, my dear friends. Ideas have to come in your mind. Ideas are very important. How does ideas come? Every invention, every scientific and technological development that we have been experiencing and enjoying are thoughts of human mind. They didn't fall from sky. No, no way. Everything is a thought process of somebody, some person. Some person, some idea has been converted into this. And the necessity. How do you imagine? You just think, maybe about 10 years back, if somebody were to tell, I will work from home, people would laugh. Does that make any sense? How can you work from home? Today, it's an integral part of many industries. Many people, they're working from home. That's how the evolution takes place. Evolution comes because of ideas and the necessity. And the necessity is here is the problem. And the evolution is of your thought process. See, I'll tell you a small anecdote. You know about a universal law of gravitation, which was invented by Sir Isaac Newton. How did he invent this universal law? Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes, sir, it is audible.
Thank you so much. Yeah, that's what. This universal law of gravitation, Newton was sitting under an apple tree. He was reading a book. Suddenly, an apple fell. He started brainstorming. Why did it not stay there? Why should an apple fall? The thought process that started, which evolved from Newton, led him to invent this universal law of gravitation. So, my dear friends, human body is the most sophisticated gadget on this planet Earth, and human mind, your mind, is the most advanced software till date. Have this, bear it in mind. You human, you know, like human thought process has such wonderful power within this. I'm going to tell you a very short story about this power of human thoughts. There was a woodcutter. He was staying close to a deep forest. He would go to forest, cut woods, bring them, sell in the market, and earn his daily bread. This was his usual routine he would do. He had a wife. She would go in the noon, go to him, carry the lunch, eat with him, and while coming back, both of them would come with this wood and sell it in the market. This was their routine. They were happy, they were contented, and they were hardworking couple as such. One fine day, what happened? His wife was a little unwell. She couldn't go that day. She said, no, today I'm not going to, I can't bring the lunch for you. You come back home and have lunch here only. This man, he was free that day. He went to the forest, and as he had no, you know, urgency, since his wife was not supposed to come that day, he started exploring the jungle. He started exploring the forest. He moved on a bit. Again, he went some more deep. At one point of time, it was late in the afternoon. He was feeling thirsty. He was feeling hungry. He wanted to rest for some time. He could see a different, tree. Entirely different from the normal trees. Its branches were something very shiny, very greeny, very attractive. Something like that. He felt, this tree looks so wonderful, so beautiful. Let me rest here for some time. What he did, he came under the tree. And the, it was a thorny terrain there. Thorny place, the land was very thorny. Oh, he felt, it's so hard, how can I sleep? Wish if I had a bed here. Suddenly, a silky, bed appeared. He sat on that. Oh my God, what's happening here? He was bewildered with the things what are happening over there. And he said, he must have been pleased because of my hard work, my honesty. He said, fine, fair enough. Then he said, if I had little water to drink, that would have really, quenched my thirst, he said. Suddenly, in a silver bowl, in a silver jug, a beautiful, lady came with water and served him. He was astonished. Then he said, I'm feeling very hungry. If I had something to eat, the very next moment, all different varieties of dishes and other things came, and there was a wonderful dining table, and about 2 to 3, waitress were there. They served him the wonderful food. He felt very happy, and he started thanking God. Oh my God, how did you really understand my problem? I'm so happy that you are blessing me. You have acknowledged my hard work. Then he felt, I'm feeling a little tired. If I could sleep a bit, then beautiful, whatever the bed he had, it came with a lot of pillows and other things. A good one indeed. So he went to sleep. At that time, he got a bit scared. If I sleep, if a lion comes and eats me, what's going to happen? And he heard an unknown voice, don't worry, your wish will be fulfilled. A lion came and ate him because he was sleeping under a wish tree. So what I am trying to tell you is, I am trying to manifest the thought process of human mind. It's very powerful. Human mind is very powerful. All this, as I told you, every invention is the brainchild of human beings. That's what. Ideation is very, very important. come out with, I'll be talking about the ideation a bit later. Okay, then when you ideate the things, okay, you are stuck with the idea. That doesn't mean you can go and manufacture something and simply go and sell it to them. No, it doesn't work that way. You need to develop a scaled down version of the product. Scaled down version, a miniature, a sample. You call whatever you want. You have to develop one such, we call it as minimum viable product. That means a product with basic features to address the problem. You can't completely, you know, like all pour all your money and go for a, you know, manufacture the product. No, you can't do that. Develop the lowest level, the miniature product with basic minimum features to address the issue. And next, you should send it to basic, you know, like we call them as educative customers. The customers who can give you feedback, who can give you an idea about the flaws that are happening, the different areas you'll have to improve upon regarding its features, its functionality, aesthetics, whatever it is. So it goes to educative customer. You need to take it to an educative customers and get a right feedback so that you can mend, you can make the changes, necessary changes, and go for a product. So you have to start thinking. The whole pattern is called design thinking. Design thinking is a stage-wise, non-linear, iterative, repeated process you will have to adopt. Start thinking in these areas. If you have an idea, if you want to do something, you pick a problem. You pick a problem. What is it you want to do? How does it benefit a customer? And in that particular domain, what is the problem? What are the different the difficulties, the problems that a customer is facing? Is it really a need? My dear friends, you have to, no doubt we are in a want world, but always try to embed a need in the want. That where your entrepreneurship skill lies. That's very, very vital. So you better try to practice this design thinking. It's entirely different subject altogether. Maybe it takes a lot of time to if we start talking on design thinking. Let's move further. Are you with me so far? I hope so. Yes, ideation. This is what I was talking about. How does the ideas crop up? In fact, it has been manifested by a story also. I hope you have got that. See, ideation is a short, intensive workshop-like experience. See, many, like, you know, government-funded, government organizations, and especially they do offer such ideation programs for students. So try to be a part of these ideation programs. It's an intensive workshop-like experience for students to address some of the most pressing challenges of time. So this is how ideation is a process where you will start generating the ideas. You will come up with some wonderful ideas. See, it's ideation is just come out with the ideas. You don't have to validate them right at that point in time. First, a pool of ideas have to be created. A different, maybe if it's a technological, suppose if you're working on technology, the different technologies that you can use. And there the next stage, you are going to identify the most suited, best one, and the most effective, and the economical one. In order to derive that economical one, you need to have a lot of ideas. So ideation is the process where you start generating ideas. Let your idea be crazy. Let it be stupid. It doesn't matter anything. Come out with some ideas. The screening takes place next. So these things you can do by getting in touch with more people, more client base, more user base, and more networking. My dear friends, see, networking is order of the day. The world is too small. It's like a global village. Try to be in touch with the people, start networking, connect to the people, connect to the organizations, connect to the associations. And that's how you will start getting the ideas. You can't sit, read a book and generate ideas. No, it doesn't work that way. No, it doesn't happen. Constantly, you should be in touch with the people. Constantly, you should listen to the people. Regularly, you should share your ideas and listen to others. So that's how the basic principle, the basic need of an entrepreneur is met with ideation. Ideathon, this is the process. This is a, you know, again, workshop I told you. Ideathon workshop, people do conduct. I think especially there's something called incubation centers. Well, it's a different subject altogether. I don't know whether you have an incubation center in your institution. Probably now Government of India is encouraging lots and lots of incubation centers being set up in higher education institutions. It may not be engineering alone. It may be in any institutions. So that's a complete one-stop workshop for entrepreneurship development. That is incubation. It's not in today's my program, don't worry. So such programs have to be conducted. You'll have to attend, be a part of Ideathon so that you can learn how to generate ideas. And what basis you have to generate the ideas? Basics are the need of a customer, the problems of the customer. So this is very important to generate ideas. And Ideathon is a process, is a workshop that's being conducted, I have told you. You can check, you know, Startup India website and many, you know, MSMEs and other places. A lot of such workshops are being conducted. Try, register yourself. Registration is very simple. You don't have to worry and be a part of that. You will start, you will entirely, there will be complete paradigm shift in your thought process, my dear friends. Okay. Are you with me so far? Yes. This is another area. This is another way. The most important one. This is boot camps. Boot camp. This is a short-term intense training sessions that are designed to prepare the entrepreneurs to the practical reality of development world. Yeah, that's what. Here, it's something like a simulation. You will be, you know, treated as an entrepreneur. You have to carry on all the activities of an entrepreneur in a workshop. It's a basically an intense one. You must have heard many of the, you know, like corporate, they do conduct this boot camps for their employees in order to, you know, like elevate them, in order to make them more effective in their work, you know, area. So they do conduct these boot camps. Boot camps is a, there are different categories as such. One is time bound. Another one is intensity bound. Another one is skill bound. So when you really, you know, club up all the three things, it's basically an intensive, skill bound and time bound workshop. It's very important to attend boot camps. In a, within a very short span of time, you will learn lots and lots of things. You will be exposed to the practical, you know, like terrain of business. You will be allowed to develop a product. People will mentor you. People will train you. People will guide you. And within a short span of thing, they'll be asked you to generate some ideas. And, you know, they'll be, you'll be asked to prepare, you know, a small project report, a small, you know, profile of your project and talk to your banker. There are a lot of mock things will be done. You will be taught, you will be trained. There'll be a lot of mentors. There'll be a completely team from all different areas. People from marketing, people from product development, people from finance. All will be there. All of them, they will guide you and make you to act and learn these things. So boot camps are also being conducted. Better, I would advise you to attend these boot camps. Boot camps are very, very important. They will definitely, you know, put you in some kind of a situation where you will be understanding the need of the business. So if you have an idea of a startup, I think boot camps is the best suggested workshops that you can attend. There are skill bound. I told you, know, a lot of skills will be, you know, like imparted to you over a period of time. You will be charged up. The moment you come out, maybe they conduct it for 3 months, 1 month, even shortest are there for 15 days, 8 days and all. See, many corporate, they do this for a week's time, boot camps and all, so that their employees will be taught so many different things which are not aware of the thing. And their flaws are corrected there. Because they will have a, you know, an appraisal form or whatever it is. They'll be knowing which are the, you know, pain points their employees are facing. In the same fashion, even for the entrepreneurs also, they will assess you basically. They will appraise you. What are the different areas you are lacking in? What is the different areas that you have to be taught? So they will teach you They will definitely make you to learn. This is one area. This is one of the way to foster your innovation and entrepreneurial skills. So bear it in mind. These are available. These are, you know, like these are conducted by many governmental agencies, nodal agencies. Go through them. Boot camps arranged by Government of India, you just find out. And even these people, I told incubation centers, they arrange these boot camps. It's very vital and very important and very effective too. Okay. Yeah, these are the, it's a complete, you know, graphical illustration of a boot camp. What are the benefits of a boot camp? Here they mention. See, the possibility of establishing a network of professionals, contacts within the technology sector. That's what I told you. You will be coming across people of different, you know, like networking with lots and lots of professionals there. You will be creating a new professional horizon, enhancing or recycling knowledge. Yes, knowledge is shared. Knowledge is exchanged. You will be taught, you will be guided, you will be mentored. So you will develop the flexibility they offer in an increasingly digital and changing world. This is very important because the digital market is so vast, so sensitive. You need to understand everything. Because unless you have this digital experience and knowledge and basics of digital platforms, it's very difficult. So try to learn some basics of digital marketing, digital platforms, and they're also being taught in these boot camps. So boot camps is worthy of attending. They will teach you a lot, my dear friends. Yeah, this is an entrepreneurial orientation program. Before I go into this, I was talking about the power of, you know, like communication. Is that right? How should you communicate? What is the power of words I was talking about? I will take you through a very small video. If it works here, so you will understand the power of words, my dear friends. Shall I? Are you there with me? Just a sec. Let me see in what screen I am. Entrepreneurial orientation. Fine, fair enough. Okay, I'll stop the screen. Okay, I'll share the screen. Right, share the screen. The Chrome tab.
Saying,
I wrote the same but in different words.
Thanks, love.
Was that clear? Okay. What I was telling to try was what was I trying to tell you is there are two things here in this video which can teach you. One is the power of words, the power of communication, the power of effective communication, and when being empathetic. What's happening is it, this man is begging, sitting on the roadside. He is having a bowl to beg, and there's a small board. I can't see, please help me, was the first board you saw, right? And nobody cared for him. They just looked at him, watched him, and a couple of them, few of them, gave some small pennies, and they went off. A lady who was watching all this, he was a blind man, okay. A lady who was watching, she watched and she became a bit empathetic to him. She wanted to make some change. She came there, changed the complete that board, signboard. She said, it's a beautiful day, but I can't see. The people came, when they looked at the board, they felt empathetic. They started, yes, it's such a wonderful day. This man is not being able to see the things. They started, you know, helping him around. So what I would trying is, being empathetic is always the best thing in business. And the power of words, how do you communicate? How do you communicate the things is very important. That's why communication is very vital for an entrepreneur. Need to learn the most effective ways of communication. As long as you are effective in communication, you can always expect good results, friends. So I just wanted to just manifest these two factors. That is, one is empathy and the other one is the power of words. Power of words means the power of effective communication. Yeah, these are all almost we are coming to end of my presentation. Maybe I won't take much of your time now, my friends. Yeah. These are the lessons, the most important lessons you need to learn in business, in an enterprise. To be an entrepreneur, you should learn these are all the basic things that are very, very vital. Just make a note of these things so that they can help you a lot. A pilot project is always a good idea. So if you want to be a good entrepreneur, I told you that's what a prototype. A prototype is the one, the scaled down version of the product. That's very important. So work on developing something, a model or a, you know, miniature, so that you will get the feedbacks, you will understand that taking that, you know, like a pilot project to the people will help you understand the basic needs of the people, what people want, what are the changes you can do, and how you can, you know, like improve your product. So because I'll tell you, this is a story, what happened, see, an entrepreneur or an enterprise should always have that diversification aspect in mind. Way back in 1994, Amazon started as an online book selling store. They were just selling books, nothing else. Today, maybe after 25, 30 years, maybe around 25, you can say, you name the product Amazon has for you. Why could they do it? Because they were always constantly working on the market needs. They had that idea of diversification. So you have to always constantly, you should be ready for, you should be adaptable. That's a very important lesson. Just take their example. Amazon is a US-based company. Jeff Bezos, who is the CEO of Amazon, he is sitting at Seattle, United States of America, and he is selling coriander, which is grown by you people. And he is selling it to you only. This is the cycle of business. This is because his ideas have worked. He has constantly worked on that particular, you know, customer base, customer wants, customer needs, simplification of the services to the customer. So have that. You should, in order to do that, you should always have some, you know, like sampling done, prototype done. So have that in mind before you really go to any venture. Try to develop a, you know, the scaled down version of your idea, whether it's a service or product, whatever it is, it doesn't matter. So we are, the second one is worrying and focus and go. Stop worrying. The one common thing what humans do is we dig the past and worry about the future. Worry about the future, which is unknown. That's important. If you know about the future and worrying it about it makes a sense. But when you don't know the future, why should you worry? And if you start digging the past, nothing works. Forget it. It happened is happened. So try to be in presence. Try to live the present. That's very, very important. So don't worry. So you don't think too much of, have some foresight, not an issue. But you should never worry. You should also work on future, not worry about the future. You work on future goals. Focus on your goals. So don't brood over the mistakes you have done. No point in despairing over mistakes. So the next one is adapt to changes. Very, very important. You should be vulnerable. You should be in a position to adapt yourself to the changes that are happening around. Maybe you should be in a position to diversify your product. Diversify your services. Go to the next level. You find out which is an alternative to that. In what way it can serve the customer in a better way. So change, adoption is very, very important, my friend. So change is always a constant one. Bear it in mind. Don't get impatient for results. Because there's nothing called shortcut. There's no shortcut for success. Success is a progressive journey. You have to be patient enough to reap the benefits. So be patient enough. And the most important quality you should cultivate is admire and respect your rivals in business. No doubt you are competing with them. That doesn't mean you should, you know, hate them. No way. Try to respect your, you know, rivals. Admire them for the work they have done. And the next one is learning is a continuous process. Don't say no to learning. Keep on learning. It's not my way or the highway. Don't stick on to anything. Because see, changes will always happen. Whatever, don't think, don't be under the wrong impression. There's always a set pattern to do this. Nothing like that. Or don't think whatever you are doing is right. No. It's neither your way nor highway. There are so many options, so many permutations and combinations in which you can work to find out the best solution. Always, it's not what you know. What you know is not so important when compared to who you know. You should know people. You should know people's attitude, people behavior, people needs, people wants, people skills. When you understand everything about people, you will know what you should do. So these are all the very, very important 9 points I noted down, which are very, very vital, important, and they should be an integral part of improving your entrepreneurial skills, my friends. Hope you got that clear. Yeah. Before I conclude my session, I would urge you to visit Startup India. This is a wonderful flagship government program. You have lots and lots of learning opportunities there as students, especially. They will teach you everything. You don't have to, you know, like be an entrepreneur only. As a student, you can register. Different programs are being offered. Many online programs. You can learn a lot about entrepreneurship and you'll be, you know, marketing, sales. Short, you know, like crash courses are being offered. Try to be a part of it. It's a complete networking platform also. You will come in contact with wonderful people, experienced stalwarts of business. You can know about them, know about their service, products, everything and all. So I would urge you to go to this portal and take benefit out of it. Hope I have done justice to the subject I have been given today. I'm very glad. I'm so happy you made me a part of this wonderful learning session. Before I wind up my program, I just want to you know, navigate through a very simple story about success, my dear friends. See, we are all longing for success. We want to be successful in personal as professional life. This is what the life is all about. We'll always be thinking, I want to succeed. I want to achieve something. I want to do something. And we fix ourselves certain targets also, isn't it? But what is this success? How do you attain success? How do we understand what this success is all about? This simple story manifests that will give you a broad spectrum of what success is all about. There was a young man. He was longing, he was struggling to be successful in life, both in personal and professional life. He tried in all possible hard ways. He couldn't. One of his friends suggested to him, hey, why don't you go to Socrates? Socrates, he is a Greek philosopher. He is the co-founder, one of the founders of Greek philosophy. I hope you know him. He said, he's a great man. He will tell you, he will teach you how to be successful in life. This young man, this boy, okay, fine, fair enough. I will go and meet Socrates. He went to Socrates and he told him, sir, I want to be successful in life. What is that I can do? Socrates said, oh, great. You want to be successful in life? You want to succeed? You come to me tomorrow morning. This boy got puzzled. What is this? I asked him for a certain secret, but he's asking me to come tomorrow. It's okay. Doesn't matter. Let me come tomorrow. He came next day morning. Socrates took him and they were walking by the side of a river. He was silent. He didn't speak anything. He was anxiously waiting. He could say something about success. He may reveal the secret. But he didn't. He took him by hand, started entering into this river. He was worried, what is this he's going to do? And at the point of time when that water came to the neck level, Socrates held him by neck and plunged him deep into the water. This man started struggling and he was annoyed he may die. And at some point of time, his face started turning blue. Socrates understood the intensity of the situation and pulled him out. This man took a deep breath and said, sir, what is this you're doing for me? I was asking for success, but you are, you know, plunging me deep into the water. It's not fair, he said. He said, I want to ask you one question. What is that you wanted most when you were inside water? This young man said, sir, I wanted air. So, as long as you want success as much as you want air for life, you will succeed. What I'm trying to tell you is, you are breathing, you want air, you want oxygen every minute. The same way, let the thought process of success be a part of your life. Don't give too much importance to that. Live in that. And success is a progressive journey. It's not destiny. Every point of time in that journey, you reach some target. Don't be complacent. There will always be room for value addition. And just enjoy that journey. This is all about success, my dear friends. I take this opportunity to thank the whole management and the IAC team and the conveners and the invitees, the management of these great institutions. And especially, I hope, I thank you again for having listened to me with so much of patience. And I feel elevated and I feel truly honored and blessed by your good gesture of giving me an opportunity to do this, ma'am. Thank you so much, all of you. Yeah. What is the hardest part or become good entrepreneur? See, there is nothing called hardest part, my dear friend. This is the mindset. See, everything is about the power of our mind, the mindset. You need to cultivate. See, hardest, there's nothing but hardest. When you start traveling the journey, always you will always have a solution. But hardest part is to convert, to change your mindset. Have that. Because what happens? Mind, I told you the power of mind. So please work on your mindset. Open up yourself to different terrains, different areas, different segments. You cultivate a different mindset. So mindset is the one which is very hard. Unless you have the right mindset, you cannot be a successful entrepreneur. Any questions, please? Yeah. Wonderful question. See, there is nothing called satisfying a consumer. What's happening is, it's a transitional journey that takes place. The thing is, you have to have something called USP. Unique selling. You have something unique in your product. How does it differ? You can convince a customer when either your service is better, I mean the product or the service is better, or the cost factor. So you can convince a customer by offering better quality, better salient features, better life, better aesthetics, and little lesser cost. This is how the whole marketing takes place. I told you work on value addition to the product and the reduction in cost. Reduction cost may not happen all the time, but the basic thing is every day the want, the technology is changing around. So try to, you know, like adopt new things, new salient features, new offerings to the customers. And of course, selling is a different art, which we can speak later. But when I really work on certain basics in this is, that's what, give good, you know, products and services. Let there be value additions. Because what's happening is most of the time that when we meet a customer, we are going to replace something which are already using, isn't it? Very few, you know, like products are new. Most of the products are, we always, some competitor is there or somebody is doing. So what you do is go with better salient features, advantages, have something unique in your product. Let it be different from others. So that's how you can basically satisfy a customer. There are so many other things to deal with the customer. Hope I made that clear to a reasonable extent.
Definitely, sir. So one more question. What is the procedure to get product license while we are making the new product?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, it's a very, you know, important questions. But what happens, see, most of us, the moment we have some product idea, we want to do something at all. Of course, yes. There are certain regulations, certain compliances one has to meet. But over a period of time, the whole, you know, procedure that we are no more living in license raj. Not much of compliances have to be met. Suppose at a district level, I think, suppose if you are somewhere in Chennai district, or maybe in a district of Chennai, you are located, you want to start something here. There's one thing called district industry centers or some offices that are part of MSMEs. They are the part of the subsidiary of MSME. They are district industry center. You need to have a registration there, a simple registration. We call it as provisional registration certificate. You need to obtain one such. I don't know whether what they call it right now. It was called PRC. Have obtained a license as an entrepreneur. And there is one thing called Aadhaar, you know, like identification. That's what they give in the form of Aadhaar. Once you submit your Aadhaar and your product, whatever it is, whatever the product you just mentioned, you will get Aadhaar identified certificate. That is the basic thing. Along with that, you need to have a, you know, like a GST. That's very important. Since you are into business, I think these are the just two basic ones. And depending on the areas you want to start. Suppose if you want to go into pharmaceuticals, you may have to have drug license. Depending on the domain, depending on the different service or, you know, like the product you are going to manufacture, you may need additional affiliations or maybe compliances. But to start with, this Aadhaar identification, that's Aadhaar Udyog Aadhaar, they call it as Udyog Aadhaar, and the GST. These two are sufficient for you to. And now for the next 3 years, you start your industry, nobody is going to disturb you. Because lots and lots of, you know, like benefits, schemes, they are offered to startups. Many, many things. That's what I think. I would urge all of you to get into this Startup India website. There are 124 schemes for so many products. All the product. You name the product, you name the service, there is a certain scheme. Hope I made that clear, ma'am. Anything else?
Yes, sir. One more question from our side.
Yeah, please.
What is the ways for finding new customers?
Oh, what is the ways to find new customers?
New customers.
Okay. See, what happens is here, I'll take these questions in two dimensions. One is customer and the new ways. See, there is nothing called vacuum. There is nothing called vacancy in the market. Suppose if you are coming with a product which is already in the market, I told you, you have to come with some new ideas, new, better salient features, and you are going to knock down, you are going to eat away somebody's bread. This is one part. Suppose if you are thinking you want to create a customer base, you have to come up with something new which customer is not aware. You will have to study what are the needs of the customer. Maybe because now, you know, lots and lots of mobile applications are being built. So you have to find out one service which is not tapped so far. So you have to work on some equation, some product or service which is not being offered to the customer. So developing a new customer base is nothing but developing a new product. That's what is all about. But if you are working on existing products and existing service, it's only by, you know, like value addition. And see, day by day, see, it's a process of evolution. It's not nothing, you can't learn anything overnight. And customers, they are so sensitive. This every day is happening. There's a change in customer mindset, customer wants, customer needs. You should be meticulous enough to study this. That's what customer understanding, customer behavior is a different science altogether. But you are, attention should be customer oriented. That's how when you come out with something which is definitely new, you can create a customer base. Maybe my answer may be vague, but still, this is how the whole scenario works, ma'am.
Thank you so much, sir, for your valuable ideas while you are sharing today. Thank you, sir.
Hope students have understood a bit. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. May God bless you all. Yes, you have anything?
No, sir. Thank you for your...
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
As we express our gratitude, we must never forget that the highest appreciation is not to utter words, but to live by them.
First of all,
I want to thank today's chief guest, Mr. B.S. Lokesh, for spending his valuable time to make this event informative and a valuable one. I sincerely thank Chevalier Dr. N.R. Dhanapalan sir, Mr. N.R.D. Prem Kumar sir, Mr. P.R. Prem Chand sir, Dr. C. Inita Eben, Lebanon Ebensi Madam, Mrs. Jofia Solomon Madam, for their constant support in all endeavors. Nothing could be possible without the support of the IAC team and faculty members to conduct the webinar wonderfully. Thank you, IAC team. Last but not the least, I want to thank all the viewers for their active participation. I request the participants to kindly fill the feedback form and to receive the e-certificates. Thank you, one and all. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much.